Well, good morning, Emmaus Road Church. Those of you gathered with us this morning and those worshiping online, I greet you in the name of Christ, who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be exploited and used to his own advantage, but took the very form of a servant. This morning, as we worship, may the model of Christ inspire us, and may the Holy Spirit of Christ fill us as we worship together. Those of you in the room, I invite you to stand. Let's join together in this call to worship.
This will be a responsive call to worship, so please join me as instructed on the screens. The Lord is making a new covenant with the people of God. Here in this place, Christ writes the law of love on our hearts. We are children of the living God. Together, let us worship the Lord of love. Amen. Come and stand before your Maker, full of wonder we revere. Come behold his power and glory, yet with confidence draw near. For the one who holds the heavens and commands the stars above is the God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love.
Come and lift your hands and raise. His hands are the depths of the earth. With one voice we proclaim His great word, Lord our God. And we will seek Him, our rock of salvation.
Worship you this morning. And God, all of us, we come to this place, this moment, whether it's here in this building or joining us online, we come with our own experiences of what the last 24, 48, 72 hours has brought. Some of those have been moments of joy. For some of us, those have been moments of challenge, heartbreak, sorrow. But Lord, wherever we're coming from, as we gather together, your people, to worship you, we gather in front of your cross, thanking you for the gift of forgiveness and salvation. Lord, you make us all one. You make us family. So church family, please join me in praying our corporate prayer this morning. This is from the Book of Common Prayer for the fifth week of Lent. It'll be on the screens for you. Please join me. Almighty God, you alone can bring order the unruly wills and affections of sinners. Grant your people grace to love what you command and desire what you promise, that among the swift and varied changes of this world, our hearts may surely there be fixed where true joys are to be found, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. In church, 1 John 1:9 gives us this assurance of forgiveness. It says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Please join me in saying, thanks be to God.
Kids, I hope you all had a fun spring break playing in the snow. turn to a family member and tell them something that you enjoyed about spring break. Today we continue in the book of Lamentations in chapter 4. Now let's review a little bit. Lamentations is in the Old Testament, and it's made up of poems of lament. And lament means to grieve or be sad or angry or frustrated. And it's us telling that to God. God welcomes our lament, just like a family member or a good friend wants to hear about bad days, not just good days. One day, God is going to make all things new, and all of the wrong things that we lament will be made right. This is great news, and it gives us a lot of hope. But while we have this hope in God, it's still okay for us to lament the things that aren't right. In chapter 4, we are going to hear about how things used to be and how things are right now. This is more lamenting, even though we just heard in chapter 3 about hope in God. We're back to lamenting. In verse 1, it tells us that even the finest gold has become dull, and sacred gemstones lie in the streets. Like these shiny, beautiful coins. That had Arches National Park on it. Become tarnished and gross looking and dull. This one's from 1980. And then in verse 2, it says, "See how the precious children of Jerusalem, worth their weight in fine gold, are now treated like pots of clay made by a common potter." And verses 3 and 4 tell us about how parents ignore their children's cries for food. Yikes. Now, the children used to be treated like gold, but now are treated like common pots of clay. And this is common is probably the nicest thing you could say about this pot of Play-Doh that I manufactured. That's a big difference, isn't it? In verse 5, it says that even the people who used to eat the best, most delicious, most expensive food and wear the finest clothes now beg in the streets and get food from garbage dumps. Gross. That's a really big change. Can you imagine seeing somebody who was once very, very wealthy now digging in a garbage can to find something to eat? The writer is telling us how things used to be so good and now in their suffering are so, so bad. The suffering is affecting everyone. Suffering isn't just something that happens only to one type of person. It can happen to anybody, even the most wealthy people. And it can even affect the most precious, the children. But on that very first Christmas, God came to earth as a little baby. I know, who knew you'd be hearing a Christmas story just a few weeks before Easter, right? God came to earth as a little baby. Jesus was born. Jesus came to be with us in our world affected by sin and evil to make it new. Jesus is with us in our suffering and making it new. Now everyone suffers, the rich and the poor, the sick and the healthy, the old and the young. Everybody experiences suffering. We can be examples of God's love and hope by helping care for other people when they are suffering. There are so many ways to care for people who are suffering. And there are so many people who face extra challenges in their suffering because they don't have the same support and privileges as some of us do. Isn't that really unfair? Not everyone has a great doctor when they are sick. Not everyone gets the same help when they struggle with schoolwork. And not everyone can afford to eat every time they're hungry. God came to earth to be with us in our suffering and to make all the wrong things right. And we can follow God's example by being with people who are suffering and doing what we can to care for them during their hard situation. Now, I want you to think of one person in your class who you can tell is having a hard time for whatever reason, even if you don't know why. Can you think of a few ways that you can care for them and give them some extra support for the rest of the school year? You can think more about this while Pastor Andy is preaching. Now let's get our eKids bulletins out. If you're here in the sanctuary, you can find them at the eKids check-in desk. And if you're at home, you should be able to print them off. Now let's learn more about Lamentations 4 and join Pastor Andy for the sermon.
Well, good morning. Okay, there for a minute, I didn't know if anybody was here. Good morning. It's great to be with you. Before I start in this morning's message, I want to share just a couple of announcements of things that you'll want to be aware of, and that is 2 weeks from this morning is Easter Sunday on April 4th, and I hope that you'll make plans to join us for just a really great celebration of resurrection and new life. Health and safety protocols will be in place for Easter Sunday, but we want to do everything that we can to celebrate. And so we are happy to be able to host this year an Easter party after the service or following the service with some COVID-safe activities that'll be hosted outside in the courtyard. And so it'll be a great time. And for those of you that have been around for a little while, you'll know that our Easter party is usually prior to the morning worship service. This year, it'll be just for a few minutes after the service, so plan to stick around. So worship at 10 a.m. to 11 or 11:15, and then the Easter party for like 11:15 to 11:30, 11:45, something like that. We hope you'll make plans to join us. Of course, the service will also be streamed online if you're not yet ready to join us in person. We certainly understand. So Easter Sunday coming up just in a couple weeks. The other thing is, I wonder if you would be available to help us clean up the outside of our building with like some spring cleanup work on the Saturday before. So Saturday, April 3rd, about 8 to 10, just a couple hours. We'd love to have your help in helping to make things look springy and beautiful for our Easter service. So if you have any questions about what activities will be done or what work will be done or how you might be able to get involved, I encourage you to contact Nina Rattle, who's helping us to coordinate that event. And then also, before I jump into this morning's message, I want to say a huge thanks to Pastor Grace for bringing the message last Sunday on Lamentations chapter 3. Phenomenal message, and just a great word from Pastor Grace. So when I said, hey, I think I'm going to be out of town March 14th, and we're going to be in this series, Lamentations, would you be willing to continue the series and preach through that? Which is a pretty tall order. And Grace was like, yes, I will do it. She stepped right in, did a phenomenal job. So thank you so much, Pastor Grace, for a good message last week. Well, as I've mentioned, during Lent, we've been on a journey of seeking to understand faith through the lens of lament. We've discovered that these poems of lament in the scriptures, in this book called Lamentations, help give expression to suffering. They provide a place of resonance for those that have walked through trauma. And ultimately, what these things show us is that God is invited into these spaces of our suffering in order to do God's redemptive work. The real point, the real thrust of Lamentations is that it gives expression to the human experience and says that even in these spaces, God reaches in and does redemptive work. I have found, even though the book on the surface is very, very discouraging because of its context, I have found tremendous hope teaching and preaching through it. There's something unique about these poems that Grace touched on last week that I want to expand on just a little bit. And that is that the first, second, and fourth poems all follow what is called an alphabet structure. They're each 22 verses long, and there are 22 letters in the Hebrew alphabet. And so each verse begins with the next letter in the Hebrew alphabet. And so while the poems are describing lots and lots of chaos, they're actually structured in very ordered, organized, and neat ways. Now, the third poem actually follows the same structure, but expands it a bit. It's the longest poem in the book. And so instead of just one verse per letter, there are three verses given to each letter in the Hebrew alphabet, meaning that chapter three is 66 verses. And you might, now, I'm not telling you this because this is just kind of cute information to know, right? I'm telling you this because it actually points us to part of the meaning of the poems themselves, that these poems, while they describe chaos and disorder, do it in a very ordered and organized way. So while the world of the poet is completely out of control, the poet communicates this chaos in a totally controlled or organized way, as if to say, this is the one thing I can control. You with me? Right? Like, have you ever been in a situation in your life where it just feels like your life is spiraling out of control? Isn't it true that we grasp onto the one thing that we feel like we can control? Here's another way of thinking about it. It's as though the Israelite people are venting their anger, their frustration, their grief. They're venting that to God as though to say, here is our suffering from A to Z. It's just like God can handle honesty. God can handle this spelling out of suffering from A to Z. Now structure is changes in chapter 5, which we'll talk about next week. So with that kind of little bit of context in mind, I want to invite us to read a portion of Lamentations chapter 4. And I want to read verses 2 through 9, Lamentations chapter 4, verses 2 through 9, and I'll be reading from the New Living Translation. It says this, "See how the precious children of Jerusalem, worth their weight in fine gold, are now treated like pots of clay made by a common potter. Even the jackals feed their young, but not my people Israel. They ignore their children's cries like ostriches in the desert. The parched tongues of the little ones stick to the roof of their mouths in thirst, and the children cry for bread, but no one has any to give them. The people who once ate the richest foods now beg in the streets for anything they can get. Those who once wore the finest clothes now search the garbage dumps for food. The guilt of my people is greater than that of Sodom, where utter disaster struck in a moment and no hand offered help. Our princes once glowed with health, brighter than snow, whiter than milk. Their faces were as ruddy as rubies, their appearance as fine as jewels. But now their faces are blacker than soot. No one recognizes them in the streets. Their skin sticks to their bones. It's as dry and as hard as wood. Those killed by the sword are better off than those who die in hunger. Starving, they waste away for lack of food from the fields." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now, having just heard an incredible word of hope toward the end of chapter 3, and you'll remember that the only sign of hope in the entire book of Lamentations is, in fact, when the author declares that God's mercies are new every morning. But after declaring that incredible word of hope, chapter 4 takes a turn and goes deeper into lament. So any thought that the book was kind of churning a corner into more hopeful ground is quickly put away. This poem makes consistent comparison between the way things were in the past and the way things are now during the Jerusalem siege. You remember the specific historical context of Lamentations is that when the people of Israel living in Jerusalem had the Babylonian army come and lay siege to the city for a year and a half, there was violence, war, famine, incredible suffering before they were then carted off into Babylon, into exile. It is by far the defining moment, the suffering moment for the people of Israel. And so, you think, oh, we're turning a corner toward hope, there's going to be good news, but in fact, it's just more and more lament. The point is that chapter 4 takes a deeper dive. So the poem does this. It makes this consistent comparison between the way things were and the way things are now. And here are some of the author's reflections. Children used to play in the streets and laugh together, but now they are left to beg for food. The wealthy used to eat fancy meals only to find themselves now scavenging for food on the ground, even going into the trash. The leaders of the city were once filled with splendor, but now are dirty, ragged, and unrecognizable. Pretty wild reflections. And these are just some of the examples that, of course, the chapter 4 goes on and on and on, continuing to make these comparisons of the way things, how the way they were, and then how they are now. And the point, as I've mentioned, is that chapter 4 takes a deeper dive into lament. There is this swirling around of suffering because of injustice, because of sin, because of things beyond their control. It's like this stew of emotion and thoughts on why this is happening. And what I want to do this morning is I want to make three observations about these things. The first is just in general, kind of flying from 10,000 feet. And then the next two are specific to the verses that we read. But I want to make three observations this morning. The first one, kind of flying from 10,000 feet, what are we supposed to understand from this book that gives us a word of hope and then dives deeper into lament? What are we to take from that, and how are we to understand that? Because as Christians, particularly as evangelical Christians, we don't do a very good job of lament, right? That's part of why we're doing this series, is to try to bring a more full-bodied expression of faith to the human experience. We want to go quickly into hope, and what I want to actually argue this morning is that hope and lament can coexist, that they can kind of be in tension with one another. So the first observation is this. The need for lament continues for as long as injustice and sin continue. The need for lament continues even for as long as injustice and sin continue. Maybe you've noticed in your life that life does not always resolve the way that we had hoped. Situations don't always resolve the way that we want. Our lives aren't just this like neat collection of predictable outcomes. You might find, you know, after many years of investment in a family, the family still is unhealthy in destructive patterns. You might find that youth discipled for years can still make poor and destructive choices. You might even find that with passion and with diligence, the work toward justice and toward healing can still result in unjust systems and sinful systems. If you're not sure what I mean by that, or if you'd like to take a deeper dive into that, I commend to you the documentary called Poverty, Inc., which looks at systems of global aid. While many are well-intentioned and do good work, sometimes actually keep people poor or actually are causes for greater poverty. And so there's kind of this business to world aid. And so even well-meaning, justice-oriented, healing-oriented efforts can sometimes lead to unjust systems because life doesn't always pan out the way that we had always hoped or predicted. Life isn't a formula of predictable outcomes. The truth is that life is messy, it is complicated, and it is nuanced, right? And so Christians, though, haven't always understood this or always haven't been willing to understand this. For those of you that were engrossed in Christian subculture of the early 2000s, you might remember a book, a little book, called The Prayer of Jabez. And this book focused on a two-line prayer from an obscure Old Testament character that we really know nothing about other than he prayed this prayer. And it took those two lines, that prayer, and turned in, turned it into a whole theological system and also an industry of products. You probably read the book. You maybe had the bookmarks and posters and all the things, right? There was no end to what you could kind of put the prayer of Jabez on. But what was this book, and why did it become wildly popular? Well, it was a prayer that the book claimed that if you pray this prayer every day for 30 days, then God will have, and this is the words of the author, no choice but to bless you and expand your territory. If you hold up your end, God will thereby be obligated to hold up his end. Woo! That's right. Okay, so the book became wildly popular, sold tens of millions of copies. And it was so popular because it did exactly this. It put forth a formula of predictable outcomes. Do you want to be blessed? Do you want your business to grow? Do you want your church to double in size in a year? Pray this prayer for 30 days, and God has no choice but to do this for you. It will unlock God's blessings in your life. The subtitle of the book is even Breaking Through to the Blessed Life. Is the subtitle of the book. But as the popularity of the book waned due to human experience, we find that this book, in fact, wasn't true to the human experience. That life is not a collection of predictable outcomes. And so the fact that we have sort of this amazing word of hope in chapter 3, and we think, oh, it's just turning a corner into more and greater words of hope, but then in fact takes a deeper dive into lament, as I think just there to show us that there is cause for lament for as long as there is injustice and sin. And so while life, and this is where I want to hold the tension, right? Because some of you are getting nervous. Our pastor doesn't believe in hope or blessing. I believe in hope, and God can bless you, I promise. Okay? So I can see some of you like already composing the email, right? So, but let me hold this intention. While life is not a formula of predictable outcomes, I believe that we can rest in the hope of redemption. Life is not a formula of predictable outcomes, but we can rest in the hope of redemption. We can have hope that things will be made right by the Creator. And so while things aren't right, we lament as a way of faithfully engaging with God who will make all things new. So in this way, lament is not a loss of hope, but lament, and I want you to hear this, is an expression of hope. Lament is not the loss of hope, but rather lament is the expression of hope. It's an engagement of relationship with God. It's an honesty with God that these are things that are wrong from A all the way to Z, being honest with God and then holding that intention with God, your mercies are new every morning, and great is your faithfulness. Right? It's this powerful thing. And so what this means is, just as the conditions for suffering persist, so does our lament. I'm doing this series to help introduce a language of lament to a group of Christians who, if you kind of grew up in modern evangelical church America, you probably didn't have language for lament, right? And so we're just trying to provide a little bit more language for hope and for faith. And our tendency is to say, this doesn't look like hope, this doesn't feel like faith, but I want us to recognize that in fact it is, to be able to name the pain, name the suffering, and invite God's healing into it. Amen. Okay, so this does not then mean that we are overwhelmed by sadness or that we are overwhelmed by despair, but rather it just simply means that we have a full-bodied faith that is honest and willing to engage in the hard realities of life. And to me, that just feels a lot more authentic than kind of a hoo-ha faith that everything always has to be right because I don't have permission for when things aren't. Right? Okay, so that's the first observation. The second observation is this. The most revered among us are only human. Let me explain this, right? Because some of you are like, duh, right? But let me explain this. So look at verses 7 and 8. It says this, our princes, are those honored among us, the most revered among us. Our princes once glowed with health, brighter than snow, whiter than milk. Their faces were like rubies, their appearance like fine jewels. But now, that's how things were. But now things, their faces are black as soot. No one recognizes them in the streets. Their skin sticks to their bones. It's as dry and as hard as wood. Right? There's a then and then there's a now. There's a before COVID and a COVID, right? If this ought to be like real true to the human experience. There was a then and now there's a now. And those two things are drastically different. And all of us together are trying to navigate, and we're kind of hoping for the then, we're wrestling with the now, we're wondering what will be in the future, and will it be like that? Will it be different? How will this now, this moment, impact what is to come? And all of these kinds of things, right? So this idea of this lament of then and now maybe is a good exercise for you personally. If you find yourself emotionally overwhelmed by COVID, maybe one spiritual exercise you could participate in is write your own lament and structure it like chapter 4. There was a then, and now there's a now. And let's invite God's healing into the now. And let's seek to recognize how God is at work and how God is present in the now, even though it looks really different than the back then, right? Okay, so notice the contrast between these two verses. One, the princes of society in the picture are the picture of success and beauty, but now their face is suffering. They are brought low. They are made unrecognizable. And isn't it true that our culture and many cultures, I would say most cultures throughout history, have revered those who look the best or have the most as being the people of greatest worth? You either look the best or you have the most. If you have both of those things, you are definitely revered in culture. You are deemed and given more value by the culture. Celebrity is the term that we use to describe this phenomenon. Okay, celebrity is the term that we use to describe the people that we revere as more valuable. And the Latin root of our word celebrity means honored. So we honor those who have the most. We honor those who have the most beauty or the most political power. But what this lament does is it says those who are most revered for their wealth or their power are revealed to be human just like us, just like you and I. They are revealed to be part of this thing called shared humanity. Now, this may not seem like much, but it seems to me that our culture, American culture, is fascinated with celebrity. We have shows about celebrity. We have like people that are like, why are they famous? They're famous because they're famous. Like nobody even knows why they're famous, right? It's not like they are an artist of some kind or singer, this or that. They're just famous because they're famous, right? And so what this is, so imagine this. This lament reveals them as being only human, and they're saying they're in the streets but completely unrecognizable. So imagine President Obama, President Trump, President Biden, any of them, or any living president, imagine them going into the streets and having no one recognize them. That would be something, wouldn't it? Or imagine Taylor Swift going to get groceries, and she just goes and gets groceries. Right? That would be quite a deal. That would be news in our culture, right? It's like Taylor Swift went to get groceries and there wasn't a mob of cameras surrounding her trying to get pictures. And she was able to do this because while appreciating her art, no one cared that she was getting groceries. Now, I know that none of you care about Taylor Swift getting her groceries, but trust me, millions of people really care what celebrities are wearing that day, what they're doing that day, and where they're going that day. But so imagine this world where celebrities just go in the streets and they're unrecognizable. Or maybe even more far-fetched, we know who they are, but we recognize them as being of equal value and worth to everyone else, and not greater value. We do not live in this world. We live in a world of celebrity. Lamentations chapter 4 challenges the celebrity impulse by pointing out that suffering and injustice are no respecter of celebrity or power or beauty or platform. There is this universality to the human experience. Now, with this in mind, consider what is theologically known as the incarnation of Christ. That is, the Word of God, the pre-existent Word of God, who is made flesh in the person of Jesus. God held the highest privilege and honor, and yet let all of that go in order to enter the human experience, to experience the universality of what it means to be human. The Creator God became unrecognizable, and he entered into the injustice, the sin, and the brokenness in order that he might redeem it. So may we come to see Lamentations chapter 4 not just as a critique of celebrity, although it certainly is that, and maybe all the ways that celebrity culture has entered the church, but may we also see it as a reminder of what God has done for us in Christ. And then, the third observation. It is the most vulnerable, or the innocent, who suffer the most. It's the innocent and most vulnerable who suffer the most. Verses 3 and 4 describe the toll that the siege has taken on the children of Jerusalem, which is pretty uncomfortable to read, particularly if you're a parent or if you have a child anywhere in the world that you love. I think that probably captures all of us, right? That we read these verses about children being so thirsty that their tongues stick to the roof of their mouth. They're hungry, but either no one does feed them or no one has any food to feed them, right? And these are difficult verses to read. And there's, it even points out that even animals feed their children, but the people of Jerusalem cannot, and their children are left hungry and thirsty. And this points us to the important truth. It is the most vulnerable who suffer the most in a broken world. It is the most vulnerable who suffer the most in a broken world. Have you noticed? It is never the manager of a hedge fund who is waving his arms on his roof in a flood from a hurricane. It is not the ones with a steady job with insurance that flock to public health clinics during a pandemic. That it is suffering and disaster and injustice are all common to the human experience. That's what we learned in the second observation. The suffering is no respecter of status or power, and yet we hold that in tension with that in times of brokenness in the world, it is the most vulnerable who suffer the most. And so suffering, disaster, injustice are all common to human experience, but these things disproportionately affect vulnerable communities. And so what Lamentations 4 does is it lays bare this reality by naming the effects of the siege on the children of Jerusalem. Because it's difficult to find more vulnerable populations than children. And so perhaps Lamentations chapter 4 is an invitation for us to first recognize this reality. That if we aren't there yet in our spiritual journey where we can with confidence say that this is in fact true, that in a broken world it is the most vulnerable that suffer the most, perhaps the invitation of Lamentations chapter 4 is simply to say this is in fact the case. To humble ourselves before God and seek out the truth of this by the Spirit of God and say, based on my position of privilege in the world, am I exempted from some levels of suffering that my more vulnerable neighbors are not? And I'm pretty sure that what will come back from the Spirit of Truth is that the Spirit of Truth will in fact say yes. Your privilege protects you from certain things and certain experiences in this broken world. So the first, we just need to recognize this, to admit out loud that we are less affected by an event because of our wealth, because of our access to healthcare, because of the color of our skin, like all of these kinds of things. But then to go on and to see and to know that the invitation of God, that the very heart of God demonstrated to us in the one who became flesh and became a servant, it's an invitation to know that the very heart of God is to participate in the caring of these vulnerable communities. In whatever ways that we can, in whatever channels and mechanisms are appropriate, before the people of God collectively called the church to be about the business of helping vulnerable communities. Let me tell you a story. I think I'm running out of time, but let me tell you a story. About 5 years ago, well, no, let me go back even further than that. About 9 to 10 years ago, I learned of this new program in Fort Collins called Faith Family Hospitality. And they sent out communication to all the churches, and I thought to myself, you know, that sounds like a really great program, but a really heavy tax on our volunteers. And so while learning about the program, made a decision not to pursue it. And I admit that and confess that to you today. But then about 5 years ago, there was kind of a growing awareness in me and people in our church that we needed to continue to lean into what it means to love and care and serve some of the underserved in our community. And this program, Faith Family Hospitality, came up again. And this time, having made the mistake once, this time I said, you know what, let's pursue this. And it is a heavy tax on volunteers, and it's a lot to ask of churches. But let's dip our toe in the water and let's do this and let's figure it out. And so with the help of coordinators and leaders and a kind of a group of people committed to making it happen, we began to step into volunteering and participating in Faith Family Hospitality, or now what's now called the Family Housing Network. And can I say that over the last 5 years that we've participated in this program, I will often say to the people in the program, this is the most important thing we do as a church. I think that the FFH is right at the top of some of the most important work that we do. And what I've been thrilled to see is that over the course of 5 years, not only has our volunteer base not dwindled, and what we hear from other churches is that's really common, like, the longer you get, the less volunteer interest you have, because it is a tax on volunteers. But not only has our volunteer base not dwindled, it's continued to grow over that 5 years. That as recently as our last rotation, we had 3 or 4 or 5 new volunteers stepping into the program for the very first time, caring for families, children, who find themselves in a season of homelessness. I would love for us as a church to continue to pursue not only this opportunity, but other opportunities of how we might care for those who are most vulnerable. Because in a broken world, it's the most vulnerable who suffer the most. And so let me end by saying this. Just when you thought the book of Lamentations was churning a corner toward hope, you get one of the most desperate laments. But true to the book, the author's words of lament to God become part of God's word back to us. And these powerful words reveal that the truth that the world, that reveal part of the truth about the world and what it means for us to be people of faith in it. And so my prayer is that we would listen carefully and that we would live faithfully. Amen. Amen. Let me say a word of prayer and then I'll lead us to the Lord's table today. Heavenly Father, we are thankful for this book of Lamentations that for many of us has not gotten much attention in our spiritual lives. It's a book that can be very difficult to read. And yet, Lord, when we recognize it as part of your word to us of what it means to live faithfully through the whole of human experience, we find that there is tremendous truth in it. And so, God, today help us to internalize these three observations. And perhaps there's one more than the others that is resonating in our hearts today. We pray, God, that you would speak to us and lead us. Lead us not just in new ways of thinking, but Lord, lead us in new ways of being in the world that we might experience the abundant life that you have promised. For God, we confess and we recognize today that as Christians, we believe that the best way of being in the world is to follow your teachings, to center our lives on things like love and mercy, forgiveness, and hope. So God, help us and be with us now as we gather around the Lord's table. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. For those of you worshiping online, if you haven't already, now is a great time to find elements that represent the body and blood of Christ as we gather around the Lord's table today. And for those of you in the room, as you came in, on your seats were elements for communion, so we invite you to make sure those are handy as we come to the table today. So let's gather around the Lord's table. Holy are you, Lord, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, who your Spirit led him into the wilderness for 40 days where he fasted and prepared for ministry. And then after his death and resurrection, you presented him alive to the apostles for 40 days before he was exalted to your right hand. And so now through the death and resurrection of Christ, you have delivered us from slavery to sin and death and established your people called the church. So as we prepare for the celebration of Easter, you lead us into a season of repentance of sin, of cleansing of hearts, that during these 40 days of Lent, we may reaffirm the covenant that you made with us. So pour out your Holy Spirit on us. Pour out your Spirit on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ that has been redeemed by his blood. As we gather around the Lord's table, I invite you to join me in proclaiming the mystery of our faith. That Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, he gave thanks, then he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Each time you eat it, do so in remembrance of me, and be thankful." Likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of a new covenant, which is poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Each time you drink this, do so in remembrance of me, and be thankful." And now, having celebrated the generosity of God revealed to us in the work of Jesus Christ, we commit ourselves to living lives of generosity. I invite you to hear this word, this prayer of generosity, before Christina comes up and leads us in the prayers of the people. Godliness with contentment is great gain. We bring nothing into this world and we take nothing out of it. We who call Jesus Lord devote ourselves to resisting greed, which plunges the human heart into ruin and pierces it with many griefs. We are determined to practice generosity with free hearts, fixing our hope on God and not the uncertainty of wealth. We desire to be rich in good deeds, willing to share all that we have, laying up for ourselves treasure that will not decay, but will shine in the age to come. Amen. Amen. If you're here this morning and you have prepared a financial gift, we invite you to drop that in the boxes that are located in our foyer. And for those of you that would like to give and support our ministry online, you can do so by also giving online. But I also want to mention that if you find yourself in a season of need, please do not hesitate to reach out to us as a church. We want to come alongside of you and do our best to help meet that need in whatever ways that we can. So let's welcome Christina, who will lead us in the prayers of the people.
Join me in prayer. Lord God, in the beginning you created the heavens and the earth, when the earth was formless and empty, when darkness was all that there was. And by your word you made the heavens, you spread out the earth upon the waters, and you made the great lights, the sun to govern the day, the moon and the stars to govern the night. Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. For you have set your glory in the heavens, and your love endures forever. So we praise your name, Lord. For you alone are exalted, and your splendor is above the earth and the heavens. And even so, Lord, we often find ourselves in distress. At times, we're consumed by anguish, and our strength too often fails, and we grow weak. And we grieve the ways that our health, our welfare, and our peace of mind have suffered from things and events that bring chaos and take away our abilities to control our own lives. We lament how our relationships with other people and groups have been hurt by the structures and networks that lead to stereotypes, prejudice, and discrimination. We grieve for those who are stuck in poverty and suffer injustice. And Lord, as we offer to you our laments, we are also aware of the many blessings that you do give to us. We offer you our thanks for the times that you've restored our order and stability in a chaotic world. We are grateful for our material blessings, our homes, our clothing, and our food. Thank you for the vision of peace, justice, and prosperity that we read about in the Bible. And we're thankful for those who work to bring those into a reality in this world. Let us pause for a moment and silently consider all the other good things that we have received from God and continue to give thanks. Lord, most of all, we are grateful for the gift of your Son, Jesus, who being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to take advantage of, but rather made himself nothing by taking on the very nature of a servant, being made into human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, to even die on the cross. So Lord, we come to you now with confidence that if we ask anything according to your will, you hear us. Help us to overcome despair and weariness as we place our trust in your hope of redeemed and restored lives in creation. Grant us strength to join in the work being done by others who are acting on the hope that you have provided. We pray for those who are sick among us, those who suffer from chronic disease or infirmities, for anyone facing unexpected health problems. Lord, we pray for those who have lost loved ones or are struggling to deal with those who are sick. Reveal your presence to all of those who are homebound or continue to live in isolation, Please be with the lonely and strengthen all who suffer in mind, body, or spirit. Now at this time, please add your own silent requests to these that have already been mentioned. And now, Lord, as members of your kingdom, we remember and we pray together the prayer that you first taught your disciples, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Good morning. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. Please join us in receiving our benediction. You may hold hands as you receive this commission inspired by our worship this morning. Go now and invest your lives in works of faith. May you be known for generosity and compassion. Fulfill God's holy law by putting love into action, as eagerly for others as you would for yourselves.
And may God be your defender and provider. May Christ Jesus dispel all that disturbs or disables you. And may the Holy Spirit make you rich in faith and loving and merciful in action.
We go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thank you.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures. Here be.